Oh, that was weak. Took you by surprise, didn't I? Aren't you glad love lifted you? Yeah. Hey, there you go, there you go, there you go, yeah. Well, thank you for making the choice to come out to church tonight. We're glad to have you, glad that you're here. I know there are a lot of things that we need to be praying about. We mentioned several of them this morning, Max and folks that are shut-ins and folks that are recovering from surgery, all that kind of thing. So let's continue to pray for those as we begin our Bible study tonight, okay? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for the opportunity of being able to gather together and worship and sing songs that worship and praise you and remind us of how much we need you. We need your love to lift us. I do. I need your love. I need your assurance. I need you to help me get through the week. So, Lord, thank you for doing that. And I pray that you'll guide us tonight as we study your word, that everything will be pleasing to you. Pray for all of these folks that we've mentioned that need help tonight. We pray for our country, Lord. We need a revival. We need a revival in America. We need a revival at Piney Level Baptist Church and lots of other churches around. And Lord, we just need more of you, and we need that revival. So Lord, we pray for a revival to come in America. And we thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers, and we thank you for answering our prayers. And we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Hope you have a handout. If you don't, run back there and grab you one. There's lots of passages that we're going to look at tonight. So while we're talking about this, you can be turning to some of those passages down about the middle of the page down there. Revelation and Daniel and Luke, and they're all referenced up at the top. And we're going to be looking at all of those, Lord willing, as we get there. So first of all, look up John chapter 13. That's where we're going to start. John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. John chapter 13, okay? And we'll get to that here in just a moment. I want to tell you something tonight. We're going to look at something that is shocking. Something that is shocking about God, okay? I'm sure some of you have heard this. Maybe some of you never have heard it. But prepare to be shocked in regard to who God is and what God does in our lives. By the way, there was a guy once upon a time named Karl Marx. And one of Karl Marx's sayings, of course, he was a Marxist. That's where Marxism comes from. One of his sayings was, Christianity is the opiate of the people. What he meant was normal, regular population of people have to have Christianity and they have to have God in order to feel good about themselves. God is the opiate of the people. Another one that he said was that Christianity is a crutch. Believing in God is a crutch for those who need the crutch. Well, I want to tell you something. I need a crutch, okay? I mean, I will freely admit, I need a crutch. I need help. I need as much of God as I can get. And I wouldn't call him an opiate, but I will definitely call him a crutch. I need his help. I need him to lift me up and hold me up, especially as the world around us begins to kind of fall apart as it is doing. And you know, East Tennessee is sort of a sheltered area, okay? There are lots of things that don't happen right around here that happen in lots of other places, and we talked about some of those this morning. And one of the problems with Sunday nights and Wednesday nights is that there are a lot of people who don't really see the ugliness of what goes on around us, and therefore they're not really all that concerned about it. Therefore, they don't feel the need to get more of God, more of learning about God, more of fellowship with other Christians. You know, the Bible says don't neglect the gathering of yourselves together. Well, sometimes we neglect that because we really don't think we need more than 1 hour a week. Well, I'm sorry, but I got to have a crutch, and my crutch requires me to have more than 1 hour a week, okay? I need all I can get of God and all I can get of His help to make it through the week and to deal with what I see going on all around us. So let's pray for those folks who don't yet understand or feel the need for more of God, okay? Especially in regard to what we're talking about tonight. Jesus is getting ready to go and be crucified, and he is having a last supper in the upper room, Okay? That's the setting of this thing. Now, important to understand, in this setting or any other similar setting, they had several people in one big room, and as far as we know, it was an upstairs room. So it was probably pretty large. Apparently there were 12, 13, 14 people in there. And the one of the first things that they would have had sitting on a table beside the door would have been a pitcher of water and a bowl and a towel. And I'll tell you more about that here in a moment. But that would have been there as soon as all of these folks, there were some apostles that went and prepared the room ahead of time, and they would have had that there. As soon as these folks walked into the room, a servant would have gone over and grabbed that towel and that pitcher and started washing their feet. Didn't happen. It didn't happen. But it did in another way. John chapter 13, verse 1. Now before the feast of Passover, excuse me, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. And supper being ended, in other words, they've already finished eating, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray Jesus, Jesus knew that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he was come from God and went to God. Now look at verse 4. He riseth from supper, he gets up from the table, laid aside his garments, that's his outer cloak that they wore, and took a towel and girded himself. He took that towel and tied that towel around his waist and girded himself. Notice in the old King James it says girded. We're going to see that here. Talk about that in a moment. Verse 5, after that he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded. Then cometh he to Simon Peter, and Peter saith unto him, Lord, dost thou wash my feet? And Jesus answered and said unto him, what I do thou knowest not now. You don't understand this now, but you will understand hereafter. Verse 8, Peter saith unto him, thou shalt never wash my feet. And Jesus said, well, if I don't wash thee, you have no part with me. And Simon Peter went overboard like he always did. And he said, well, then wash me all over. Not only my hands, but my head. And Jesus said, I don't need to do that. I just want to wash your feet. Yeah. Take a look at your outline, if you would, please. Nobody had bothered to grab the, there was no servant in the room. Nobody had bothered to grab the towel and grab the pitcher and grab the basin and start washing everybody's feet. That was what they did. If you walked into someone's house, of course the roads, it was almost all the time, felt like summer almost all the time there. It rarely gets really cold there. And every place that they walked, and they walked everywhere they went, you would have not seen anybody that was overweight, because the only people that were overweight were the people that worked for the government and had plenty of money and didn't have to walk everywhere they went. But these people, Jesus and his apostles, walked everywhere they went, and everywhere they went was dirt paths, dirt roads. They might have been on a Roman road at one time or another, but most of it was a dirt path, just like if you're walking out here in the field somewhere. And in the process of doing that, wearing sandals, all that dust got on their shoes and on their feet. So the common thing was in everybody's household that had a house was they beside the door they had a pitcher, they had a basin or a bowl, and they had water in the pitcher, and they had a towel hanging there. And normally if there was a servant, if not the head of the house would come and do it, but a servant would come as soon as a visitor came in through the door, servant would come, take off the sandals and wipe the person, wash the person's feet, get the dust off of their feet, and they wouldn't put their sandals back on until they started back out the door. That should have happened here. And by the way, don't get nervous. This is not a sermon on foot washing, okay? But it should have happened here. That was the normal, natural thing to happen in their day. But none of the apostles took it on themselves to go get that servant's towel and pick up that pitcher of water in that basin and start washing everybody's feet. None of them did. None of them. 12 of them, if there were 12 there, none of them did. And so finally, after supper, time had passed. After supper, the Bible says Jesus gets up and he takes off his outer garment. Of course, he had on inner garment, like they had two or three different layers of things that they wore all the time. Took off that outer garment, and he put the towel around his waist, and he started washing everybody's feet. He did that. Jesus did that. Take a look at your handout. The high priest's outfit. I want to talk about the origin of this tradition, okay? Let's talk about the high priest's outfit. And Carol has a picture up here for us, and there's a picture on the back side. You can turn your handout over, and you'll see a picture there, but it's not in color like this one is. Yeah, and to get that picture on the back of your handout kind of bigger, I had to make him sort of short and fat, right? but this one's okay here. This is what a high priest would have looked like in Old Testament times and in New Testament times. The priest, Zacharias, John the Baptist, before John the Baptist was born, John the Baptist's father-to-be, Zacharias, would have looked just like this. Maybe the colors wouldn't have been exactly the same, but they would have been very, very, very close. And you can see the ephod, if you ever see something in the Bible about an ephod, E-P-H-O-D, that's that thing on his chest that has all of the jewels. All of those jewels represent a different tribe or clan of the people of Israel, all the 12 sons of Jacob or the 12 sons of Israel. And he had all of that on, and you can't see him real well, but on the bottom of that blue robe that he has on there where the blue joins the white, there were bells on there. And those bells indicated to the people that were listening just outside the Holy of Holies whether or not the priest was still moving around. The bells would tinkle if he was moving around doing his stuff. If the bells stopped tinkling, then the people that were just outside the Holy of Holies knew that probably he's done something wrong and God struck him dead, right? And so they had you can't see it in the picture, but they had a rope tied around his ankle. And so the people that weren't high, they couldn't come into the Holy of Holies. You had to be a priest to do that. But if they stopped hearing the bells, they might holler or something and say, "You okay?" And if he didn't answer, they would take that rope and they'd pull him, that rope attached to his ankle, they would pull him out of the Holy of Holies because he's dead. He's done something wrong, or he's had a heart attack or something and he's dead. But the bells on the bottom of the blue part there are what that was. That was to help people hear whether or not the priest was still moving around, therefore still alive. But what I want to get to is the thing around his waist, and you can see that. Now, sometimes it was white, sometimes it was gold in some cases. We'll look at it here in just a moment. But in this case, it was multicolored. That was the same kind of thing that Jesus got up and took his outer garment off and took that servant's towel and wrapped it around his waist. Look back at your handout, if you would, please. The high priest's outfit, Leviticus chapter 16, verse 4. It's right there on your handout. The high priest shall put on the holy linen coat and shall have the linen undergarment on his body, and he shall be girded. There's that word girded again. He shall be girded with a linen girdle and wear the linen turban on his head. These are the holy garments. He shall bathe his body in water and then put them on. And that word girdle that's used in the Old King James, the literal meaning of that is a servant's towel. And the reason that the high priest was required by God to wear a servant's towel around his waist was to remind him that he wasn't uppity-uppity. He was a servant of the people, okay? The servant's towel indicated he was a slave. He was a slave. He was a servant of the people. He wasn't just a figurehead, wasn't just somebody that had a high position. He was someone who was there to serve people. And the towel around his waist reminded the high priest every time he put all this stuff on, when it was his turn to serve in the temple, every time he put all of that on, and then he took that linen sash, or girdle it calls it in the King James, puts it around his waist and ties it. He was reminded that he is a servant of the people. That's what Jesus did, okay? Jesus got up from the table. He went over to where the pitcher and bowl were, and he took the servant's towel, and he put that slave's towel around his waist. And by the way, the word slave or servant in the Greek language is the same thing as doulos, D-O-U-L-O-S, doulos. Doulos is the Greek word that means either slave or servant, either one, they amount to the same thing. So when Jesus put the servant's towel around his waist, he was doing what had been required for the high priest. And who designed this? In Leviticus, you can see, and in a couple other places in the Bible, you can see exactly who designed that. God designed that. Why? because God wanted to make sure that the high priest knew that he was a servant, a slave of the people. So here's God saying, this is what I want the high priest to wear. And here's God in the flesh at the upper room. And he puts on the, he says, hey, I'm no better than those guys in the Old Testament, the high priest that had to put, I'm putting the towel, the girdle, the sash around my waist, and I'm going to serve you. Middle of the page on your handout. When Jesus put on the servant's towel, he was dressing himself as a high priest and a servant of the people. Okay, now, we're going to expand on this a little bit. I want you to turn over to Revelation. We're going to go to Revelation and then Daniel and then Luke, okay? So, you might be prepared for that. Revelation chapter 1, verse 12. This is the vision that John the Revelator had on the island of Patmos as he was a very, very old man at this point. They were trying to work him to death on this island where we believe they mined marble. And in his off times, he lived apparently in a cave there, as most of them did. And he would hear from God. And God gave him this vision. And here's what he saw. First thing he saw in this vision, Revelation chapter 1, verse 12. Watch this. I turned to see the voice that spake with me. And being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. They illustrate the seven churches. And in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man. Jesus referred to himself as the Son of Man more than any other title. He said, I'm seeing what looked like Jesus, the Son of Man, clothed. He was clothed with a garment down to the foot, just like the high priest. He was girt. That's that same word, girdle, in the old King James. He was girt about the paps, or about the chest or the waist, with a golden towel. He had on a golden towel. His head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire, and his feet were like fine brass as if they burned in a furnace. And his voice was as the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword. And his face, his countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. He saw a vision of the resurrected Jesus as a high priest. And look what he has on. Look at your handout. Jesus in the midst of the churches, his waist was girded with a golden girdle or sash or towel. This was a golden servant's towel. So here's Jesus showing up to the apostle John and going to give him a revelation of what's to come in the future. And this picture that Jesus presented of himself, this vision of Jesus included that servant's towel around his waist. He was showing up as a high priest, and he was showing up with that towel around his waist. God says, I want you to know I'm a servant. I want you to know that I love you, I care about you, I serve you. And when Jesus came to earth, he was a servant as well. Now we're going to turn back, all the way back to the Old Testament, a little less than halfway back to Daniel. Daniel chapter 10. Now remember what we just read, the vision that we just read about Jesus, okay? We're going to see what Daniel saw. This is years. This is probably 700 years prior to John on the island of Patmos. Daniel chapter 10. And he's had a vision, and he's praying for the interpretation of this vision, and God's going to give it to him. Watch this. Daniel chapter 10, verse 1. In the third year of Cyrus. By the way, Cyrus was the Persian king who eventually let the people of Israel go home to Israel. He let them leave from Persia or Babylon, where they were, and let them go back home. And it was Daniel who was the assistant to King Cyrus. And God says of King Cyrus that God held his hand. Well, who did he use to hold his hand? We believe it was Daniel, who at this time was an old man. He'd been in governmental service all of his life. He'd been in the lion's den. He'd been everywhere else you can think of. And he was a trusted servant. And he was apparently a confidant of King Cyrus of Persia. And it was Cyrus that eventually let the people go back home to Israel. Okay, verse 1 again. In the third year of King Cyrus of Persia, a thing was revealed unto Daniel, whose name was called Belteshazzar. That was his Persian name or Babylonian name. And the thing was true, but the time appointed was long out in the future. And he understood the thing and had understanding of the vision. In those days I, Daniel, mourning 3 full weeks, Why was he mourning? Because he wanted to know what this vision meant. He said, I ate no pleasant bread, neither came flesh or wine in my mouth, neither did I anoint myself at all until 3 whole weeks were fulfilled. And in the 24th day of the first month, I was by the side of the great river, which is Hiddekel, and I lifted up mine eyes and looked, and behold, here we are. Behold, a certain man clothed in linen, his loins, his waist was girded. There's that old King James word. Same word used for Jesus, same word used for the high priest. He was girded with fine gold of Uphaz. Remember the vision of Jesus in Revelation? He had on a golden servant's towel. Ooh, yeah. Verse 6, his body was like beryl, and his face was like the appearance of lightning, and his eyes were as lamps of fire, and his arms and his feet the color of polished brass, and his voice of the words like the voice of a multitude. Wow. Very similar vision as what John had. So every time an angelic being like this or Jesus is seen in a vision in Scripture, and when he's in the upper room and he's washing the apostles' feet, he has on a servant's towel, a slave's towel. What in the world does that matter to us? I'm getting ready to show you. Turn over to Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12, verse 35. Jesus is speaking parables here. Most of the conservative scholars say that this parable is about the second coming of Jesus, and it's pretty clear when you read through it, and we're not going to read all of it, but when you read through it, it's pretty clear that he's talking about his own second coming, but he's using a wedding and guests of the wedding waiting on the bridegroom to show up. You remember he told a parable one time about the women that were there as guests for a wedding, and some of them, the bridegroom hadn't shown up, and some of them didn't have enough oil for their lamps, right? And others did, and they had to go try to borrow oil. And by the time they went and got their oil, the bridegroom came and they were left out. Well, this is a similar kind of a parable. And we're going to start with verse 35, Luke chapter 12, verse 35. Okay? Let your loins, he's talking to his apostles, let your loins, your waist be girded. There's that word, see that? Girded about, and your lights burning. And, oh, we're going to break our glass and let our lights shine from this morning, right? Is that what we're going to do? That's what Jesus says. Let your light burn. Don't put a bushel basket over your light. Let your light shine. Verse 36, and you yourselves liken to men that wait for their Lord when he will return from the wedding, and that when he cometh, when the Lord of the wedding cometh and knocketh on their door, they may open unto him immediately. Jesus says, I want you to be ready for me when I come, so that when I knock on your door, you'll be ready to go. Whoa. Verse 37, blessed, he says, are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. Verily I say unto you that he shall gird, oh, there's that word again, he shall gird himself and make them to sit down to a meal, and will come forth and serve them. And if he shall come in the second watch or the third watch and find them so, in other words, find them waiting and watching, blessed are those servants. And this know, that if the good man of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not have suffered his house to be broken into. Be ye therefore ready. Here's the thing that tells us it's his second coming. Be ye therefore ready also, for the Son of Man cometh at an hour when you think not, when you don't expect it. What are we talking about here? Look at your handout. Jesus' parable. Most conservative scholars believe that this parable refers to the marriage supper of the Lamb. When Jesus comes and we rise to meet him in the air, there apparently is going to be a period of time before he actually comes back with us to execute judgment on the world. And during that period of time, we're going to be at the marriage in heaven at the marriage supper of the Lamb. And Jesus is here describing that He Himself, just like He did with His apostles in the upper room, He Himself, He's going to put a towel on and He's going to serve us. You and I who know Jesus as our Savior, we'll be sitting at that huge table and the rest of the world is kind of going crazy, but we're in heaven having a marriage supper of the Lamb because we're the bride, right? Jesus calls His church the bride and He's the groom. So the marriage supper of the Lamb, Jesus is Himself, God in the flesh Himself is going to put a towel around His waist. And you and I are going to be sitting there at that table and He's going to come around and serve us. Wow. Will that be good or what? Wow. I just hope He don't serve me cucumbers. That's or stewed okra. Or tea that's made with so much stuff in it that I can't. My mom, bless her heart, she was a great cook. But she liked to mess around and put stuff in things, you know. And every time we had okra, she would stew it, and it about made me sick. She would make liver and steak and put it in gravy. Big old bowl, gravy with, and we had our own cows, so we had all of our own meat. And that thing, she'd pass that around the table, and you stick your fork in there. You didn't know if you were going to get a piece of liver or a piece of steak. And brother, I mean, whatever came out of that thing, you better eat it. That's all there was to it. And cucumbers, oh my, we had hogs. And I remember Daddy told me, he said, son, those hogs won't even eat cucumbers, so I don't eat them either. Yeah. I don't think there's going to be that at the marriage supper of the Lamb. Whatever it's going to be, I don't know what it's going to be, but whatever it's going to be, it's going to be really, really good, right? Yeah. But Jesus here is telling us, I'm going to put my towel on, and at the marriage supper of the Lamb, I am going to serve you. What is shocking about all this? That God Himself in human flesh designed the high priest's outfit to remind the high priest that he was a servant. And He in the flesh in Jesus went to the upper room and put that towel around His waist and washed His own apostles' feet. And He appears every time He's in a vision. He appears with that golden towel around His waist. And then He says, I'm going to be there and I'm going to get up and I'm going to put the towel around my waist and I will serve you. Wow. Verse 37, blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when He cometh, shall find watching. I say unto you, He, the host, the Lord of the wedding, He shall gird, He'll put the towel, gird, put the towel around His waist. He shall gird Himself and make them, the visitors, sit down to meet, and He will come forth. He will come forth and serve them. Wow. Wow. The great God of the universe, the great potentate of the universe who is sovereign, who is in charge, he's never giving up His control of this. It may look like He has, but He has not. I'll guarantee you those people that were persecuted that we talked about last week, and for 300 years, the people of God were persecuted. And finally, Constantine says, wait a minute, we're going to make Christianity the legal religion in Rome. And then Theodosius came along and said, no, we're going to make it the official religion of Rome. It took 300 years, but God eventually turned it around. Stormy O'Mardian says, sometimes people's lives are like great big oil tankers out on the ocean. They get out there, they leave the port and get out there on the ocean, and for some reason they got to turn around and go back to the port. She says it takes them a long time and a whole lot of ocean space to turn that great big thing around and go back the way from which they came. Sometimes it takes God a while to do those things. But Jesus never fails. Bottom of your handout, Jesus, our high priest, girded Himself after the style of the Old Testament high priest and served His followers, foreshadowing the day when He will gird Himself and serve us at the marriage supper of the Lamb. Think about it. The great God of heaven putting on a servant's towel and telling us, have a seat, folks. This is the time you've been waiting for. And He comes and serves us. Wow, won't that be great? Would you bow your head with me, please? Oh, Heavenly Father, we're looking forward to that time when we see this actually fulfilled in reality. The apostles saw it fulfilled in reality, but we can't see that ourselves right here physically. But we're going to see it one day if we've trusted Jesus as our Savior. And God, how
I can never thank you enough for being the kind of God that is willing to be a servant. All of this stuff about the high priest and Jesus serving with the towel on, that's all because you designed it that way. Thank you, God, for being the great servant and high potentate of heaven. Thank you, God, for loving us that much. And I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand with us, please? What are we going to sing, Miss Laura?
489, Pass Me Not.
Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. I love it. Good songs. Altar's open for you. If you need to come and pray, you come right on right now. Seems, remember, God is still in control. Revelation chapter 4, go back and reread that. God is still in control, and He is not only the high God of the universe, He is the servant. He will serve us, and He loves us, and He will listen to us when we pray, and He will answer our prayers. And we thank Him for that, Lord. Lord, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for everything you've done for us. Thank you, Lord, for being at the right hand of the throne of God and praying for us right now. Thank you, Lord. Help us to let our lights shine to the world around us. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Good night, folks.